Well, the world is really rocking now, isn't it? And imagine the reverberations that are taking place, not just physically, but in all different ways. The world is really, really, really rocking. We're now to the 17th, where I'm recording right now. It's about 10 o'clock at night, so we basically have reached the 17th, a very seminal day in between the 11th and the 23rd of September. Extremely important day, and I do have some good news. Actually, this is what this YouTube channel is all about, is good news. Good news, not terrible bad news, like, oh, you know, it's no, it's good news. All right, welcome to the video. Let me pull this in. We have some very good news. There you go. Very good news, and I'll tell you about it. And we'll go about it in a roundabout way. We like to have fun here. We lighthearted, and because we feel confident that we're on the winning side, we're on the right track. Very, very confident here. And I'll share a little story with you. I was complaining about the Holy Spirit today. I said, Holy Spirit, I've worked so hard my whole life, and you haven't really come through. Where's the beef? Where's the, you know, the success? And I was pretty, you know, I'm pretty a little bit upset, but I said, well, you know, what can I say? I know you'll come through somehow. I just don't get it, though. I really don't get it. We're here we are on the 16th and going to the 17th, and still, you know, still don't feel the way I want to feel. The perception has not been changed, has not been, you know, brought to grace. And so what in the world's going on? So I'm working in the day, and I wonder, what am I going to do after work? And suddenly I get this feeling like, you know what? You need to keep on getting in shape. Go play golf. And I said, oh, come on. I'm sore. I'm tired. I don't know. I just, why would I want to do that? And then I got this impression from the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit filled my mind with this idea and says, hey, why don't you go hit a draw today? Hit a draw. Now, golfers know what that is. Non-golfers, I can explain it. It's when you hit the driver off the tee and the ball starts out to the right and then it draws back towards the left and ends up pretty much landing in the middle of the fairway and rolling out really far. It is the greatest shot there is, really. It's the most difficult shot. It's a pro shot, and I've never been able to do it. 40 years of playing golf, I've never been able to hit a draw. And I've tried, 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 and just, you know, no, can't do it. And I've gave up a long time ago trying to hit a draw. Maybe 10 years ago, I said, this is not ever going to happen. Very few people can hit a draw, a good draw. And, you know, they say, well, you do this, and we try it, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So, and the Holy Spirit's telling me, you know what? Today, you're gonna hit a draw. Go to the golf course and play and hit a draw. I said, wow, this is really interesting. Why? What's going on here? So I did mention in a couple of videos ago that I've somehow, the Holy Spirit used this wonderful tactic on me to get me going again. I was really, haven't really played golf in a couple of years, maybe once or twice. And I've given it up. I've given the game up, actually, because of a lot of injuries and other issues, and I'm out of shape, and just forget it. No, I don't want to do it anymore. And so it didn't trick me. It used this tactic where someone invited me to a private country club. Said, hey, you know, let's play some golf sometime. I'll come out with me and play golf. And I say, oh my God, I thought, I'm completely, you know, I quit the game. I don't even know if I can play anymore. I doubt it. I'm so out of shape. I can't do this. I got real worried. And so I went right out to the golf course that very day and said, oh my gosh, I better see if I can still play. And I found out that I could play still a little bit. And so I've been going out a few times and seeing, you know, trying to get some of the rust off, and in the meantime limbering up and feeling like I'm moving better, and it's very, very, very great. So today I went out again, and the Holy Spirit said, you're going to hit a draw today. Just see if you can hit a draw. I said, I don't know how to hit a draw. I've never been able to. 40 years. It's not. I don't. I'll try. Maybe it's possible. I don't know. I had some feeling like maybe I'll find a way today where it hasn't been any way before. Now, we have this saying that golf is life. How you play in a golf course reflects your life. It reveals your life to you, which is very true. I've noticed that. It's very revealing. So I get out there and I forget to hit the drive. I'm so into trying to play and manage things, and I forget, and I'm playing horrible. I'm just like unbelievably terrible. I said, "What? Wow! What? Something's very strange is going. What's going on?" Then suddenly I remember, "Oh, the Holy Spirit wants me to practice hitting a draw. Oh yeah, that's what it is." And so I started to say, "Okay, let me try this. Let me start trying this." As soon as I started trying it, my game suddenly snapped back into place, pretty much. So, you know, I was like, wow, this is what I'm here for. And wouldn't you know it, lined up first time, and the way that I thought might work, and hit it, and hit a beautiful, beautiful draw. And I was just astonished. My mouth dropped open. I said, I've never hit one like that before. I've hit so many shots. I've never been able to hit it like that. And I said, well, let's try it again. Hit another one. I hit another one, really good one. It really went far. Oh, it was just amazing. And so I ended up hitting quite a few, you know, one after the other, after the other, after the other. And I was just astonished. So, long story short, we get to the 18th hole, and suddenly these turkeys start flooding in the fairway. Like, there's like almost 20 turkeys. I caught a 19. They're just all over the place, these turkeys on the fairway. And then we get up past them, and there's all these deers, this whole herd of 6 deers are on the other side, the right side of the fairway. Turkeys came from the left, the deers came from the right. It's like, wow, flooded with wildlife here. And on one side's the turkeys, and the other side's the deers. Yeah, I hit a great draw on that hole, too, the 18th hole, fabulous draw. And so I'm saying, you know, this is like incredibly significant. After I was complaining to the Holy Spirit, 40 years on the spiritual path, and I still, you know, don't have the what I set out to find. You know, very close, but I still don't have it. 40 years of playing golf, and I've never been able to hit a draw. So the Holy Spirit says, today you're going to hit a draw. Go to the golf course. Holy Spirit was right. Well, I guess the Holy Spirit was showing me, you know what? You're after 40 years of not being able to do something, suddenly you're able to do it. There's a spiritual significance to that. And I absolutely believe that somehow after 40 years of all this effort, suddenly I'm going to get it somehow. It's going to just click. I'm going to be able to, you know, have the, you know, change perception, the change feeling about perception, and it's going to be great. It's going to be great. So this is the Holy Spirit's way of showing me. You don't think you can get better as you get older? I'm better now than I ever have been. Like golf, for instance. I didn't play for 2 years, and I'm better than when I was playing. I took 2 years off, and I'm better now. And it's like, wow, this is quite astonishing. But it reveals your life. That means I've made a lot of progress in spiritual progress. And this hitting a draw puts you on this different level. You know, you go out there and you can hit that shot. People are going to say, wow, you know, you got that shot. Wow. Everyone will notice. If you have that shot shape, you know, they can see, wow. That's, you know, you don't see that very often. That's really good. And so, you know, it just, but getting older, we think, well, we're not going to get better. We're going to get worse. Well, it's not the case actually here. Same thing on the spiritual path. I'm getting better and better and better and better. And you know, yesterday I was able to truly bring and share to the world and bring it down to our waking consciousness here of, you know, very, very clear explanation And I'm still in the wow of that. I don't want to struggle trying to explain it again. Once the wow calms out, I'll be able to explain it, you know, very, very clearly. But obviously, I was able to do it. And I'm still aware of what I said. And how important that was. It's a huge, huge... We beat the New World Order to the punch, is what happened, actually. And so, right before the 17th of September, 2015, suddenly I'm able to hit a draw, which is, you know, the mark of someone who's very polished and skilled at golf, for instance. It's the toughest shot in golf, a really good draw off the tee. And I was hitting it. And again, I was just absolutely just astonished at this. I just, wow. So this is positive. See, it may seem like a small, small detail, but the timing of it right before the 17th, which I said is such an important day. We need to be confirmed, you know, by that day. We need to be confirmed. And we have the video yesterday, which was a confirmation of true understanding. And then today it shows up in all places in a golf game with hitting a draw off the tee. It's quite extraordinary. The correlation that somehow, and I do it very unorthodoxly, you know, I keep trying to do it the way the textbook tells you to do. I couldn't do it. I did it. I just invented a way to do it, really, that works, you know, that seems to work really, really good for me. And the same thing with the spiritual path. You know, we seem very unorthodox here, but I have a feeling we're going to get to something really, really, really good. Because, you know, those drives I was hitting, even with the various infirmities and troubles I was having, they were going a long, long way. Just as good as I've ever been, even when I was younger, you know. So this means that we're not defeated at all. In fact, things are looking better than ever. They're looking better than ever right now. So this is very, very good news that spiritually, the spiritual light is dawning, and the clarity is coming in, and the understanding is coming in, and I'm trying not to struggle with it, because this is the whole key, is just be confident that, yeah, I got it. Don't try to explain it too much. Don't try to struggle with it. You know, I'm not going to try to explain, well, how do I hit a draw? No. You know, it's just the wow is there. It's a shock. The shock is there. And just understand, you know, I'm a little bit shocked right now. So I'm not going to struggle to, you know, to clarify everything beautifully when I'm in a shocked mode. No, that's when you just full stop and don't worry about it. Later on, when this wears off, then suddenly, you know, it's clarity is going to be razor sharp. There's no question about it. So this is the key of maturity, of managing your success. When you have a huge breakthrough, you're going to get the shock. And then you just, for a while, you seem like, wow. People say, well, where's the breakthrough? You don't seem to be saying, you know, I'm in shock right now. The breakthrough was so great, I'm really hit by a lot of shock. And of course, if you know you have the answer, it's going to be a big shock. Just like now I know how to hit a draw. You know, I know how to hit a draw now. And this is a game changer for me, you know. It's just like, wow. When you know you can do something, you know you have the answer, there's a big, big shock. And so you just have to go through this time of patience. And don't try to, you know, prove yourself or explain to anybody or do anything about it. Don't struggle with it. Don't try to just do anything. Just relax and let the shock and reverberation wear off. So this is when you're skilled at this practice, full stop in the wow, success will come. Greater success than you've ever had will come, because you know how to handle it. And somehow it showed up on the golf course, amazingly, where I was able to handle that sort of success there. And just said, I said, wow, this is a big wow. So I realized that, you know, sometimes I'd get a little, I got a little self-conscious or nervous into what didn't hit as good or something. But that's understandable because I'm, doesn't matter. I was elated. I said, it doesn't matter how I play today. Nothing matters. I'm coming away with this knowing I can hit a draw now. And, you know, this is with me now. After 40 years of not being able to do it, just think of that. Being young, strong, you know, feel supple, you know, flexible, and practice. I mean, how many hundreds and hundreds of driving range, you know, gone to the driving range hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, and just hit so many shots. I could never really get it down at all. No. And then just suddenly, the Holy Spirit says, "Today, you know, go hit a draw today," and I was able to hit it. How do you explain that? I didn't even practice it. I just was on the course, you know, just playing. I just said, "I'm going to try," and boom, there it was. So the Holy Spirit knows, you know, knows our success, doesn't it? Knows when we're ready for success in some way. So we're all set up now for the next crucial few days, the 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 20, 22, six more days in the 23rd. What's going to happen? I don't know. We just got the big, I guess I was looking at the weather report, and I noticed something about some big earthquake in Chile. Well, you know, Chile's a very seismically active place, but it did rock us right on the 16th. You know, right in this mid-September time, which I said was the world is really going to go through. There's some big, impactful events set to take place, especially the meeting of the two street pavers, you know, the president and the Pope. They're going to form out company, you know, of street pavers, and they're going to pave our future, you know, pave the street that we all think, they think we're all going to go travel down. Paving the road into the future. And yet here we are saying, "Oh, wait, not so fast. We have another option, and we know what it is." We'll have the Holy Spirit pave the street, and the street will be so beautiful. The overall ambience and everything so beautiful that we say we don't even need to go down the street. This is satisfying enough. See, the idea that we're going down a street is we're looking for attainment, we're looking for status, we're looking for satisfaction, so we think we need to, you know, progress, accomplish, achieve, arrive, you know, we got to go down this road. But the Holy Spirit makes the road look so beautiful. We say, I've already arrived. I already feel accomplished. I already feel satisfied. I don't even need to go down the road. I can. It's so beautiful right now. It's all so beautiful. I think there's a song, "Oh, It's All So Beautiful." It's all so beautiful. This is what the Holy Spirit can do. So we don't need to be striving anymore, you see. We're saying, I feel I've arrived. And wherever we go, we always feel that we're already arrived. We've already arrived in beauty, you know, in attainment and whatever. The road, again, is so beautiful. We say, I don't even need to go down the road to find anything. I've already found it just looking at it. So we have this recognition in place here already. We're just getting used to it. Now, it's a very simple recognition, but a recognition that took 40 years to recognize. Just like it took 40 years to finally hit a draw. It's very similar. Because this recognition is really the most elegant recognition. You know, this is the big recognition. Just like the draw is the most elegant shot in golf, really. Because just when it seems like the ball is getting away to the right, oh no, it just beautifully comes back right in the middle. Right in the middle, you know, it's just like, wow. Like it's like somehow you had psychokinesis. Actually, you put a slight spin on the ball, and that slight spin, once the speed dies down a little bit of the trajectory, the spin of the ball then starts curving the ball a little bit. Now, I used to be able to hit draws. The pros hit draws better because the ball spun a lot more. Like the Bellotta balls, they just spun so ferociously, you know. But these days, they have these very low spin balls off the tee. They're not, you know, it's for distance. So it makes it that much more difficult to hit a draw. Very difficult. And I call it a baby draw. It's a baby draw, actually. It's not a big sweeping draw. It's a baby draw. It just, you know, it wants to go, it looks like it's going right. It wants to go right. No, it's coming back into the middle like that. Beautiful shot. Beautiful shot. And there we have a beautiful shot. And what do we say? The Holy Spirit's going to make our perception so beautiful that we say, I don't need to go down the road at all. Of expectations. I don't need a future at all. I'm satisfied with what's here right now. I don't need a future at all. I'm satisfied with what's here right now. Now, today I was looking at this and I saw some little refinement of it. And that is, if you see everything as equally beautiful, you know, then where do you gain any status? How can you gain status? So someone who wants to gain status, their whole thing is, I'm able to discern what's better than something else. Something's better than something else. That's the whole idea of gaining status, right? Is you're able to make discernments about, oh, look at this. This is more beautiful than this. I like this better than this. This kind of thing. But so if you see everything is equally beautiful, the whole thing is just perfect. I wouldn't change anything. Then how are you gain status? You think out of that? Well, you don't need to gain status because what's happening is you're in a situation where you feel like you've already arrived. Now is just fine with you. You don't need a future. Now is perfectly okay. There's nothing wrong with now. And this gets you very close then to perfection, which is not status. Perfection is not status. You see, it's not a category of status. It's singular. We're perfect. We're flawless. That's not status. We're all that way. So if we're all that way and it's just only one singular condition, that's it. We can't even bring up the concept of status at all. So those who are really, really, you know, still, you know, into status, they would be quite frightened to see that everything is equally okay with them right now. Right now is perfectly okay. I don't need any time at all. Right now is okay. Everything's okay right now. In fact, it's beautiful right now. There's no striving. You don't go down the road of time, space, process, and form. You say, hey, wait a minute. Time, space, process, and form. Right now, everything is beautiful. I don't need anything altered. No, I don't need anything added or taken away. And by the same token, if I want to go somewhere, that's also okay. Because it'll be just as good no matter where I am. It's just as good. It's all good right now. So then you're no longer in the status game at all. It's a different situation. You're in the intermediate step that brings you to true acceptance of the perfection of all. Everyone has perfect standing perfect status, but it's not status, it's perfect standing in reality. Can't be any other way than that. It's not something that is attained by getting rid of, by, you know, escaping, you know, lower status. No, it's not. So it can't be attained. It was created. We're created that way. We're spirit. We're formless spirit. So it's quite interesting. Here we have on the 16th, 8.3 earthquake, tsunamis and stuff. Maybe this is just the world saying, hey, here we go. You know, here we go. The paving crew, the paving contractors, the Pope and the P&P pavers, you know, Pope and Pontiff pavers, P&P Paving Incorporated, LLC, they're going to say, basically, that we've agreed that this is what the future is going to be. This is the road to the future. That's basically what they're getting together for, to say, we both agree that here is the road to your future, to everyone's future on this planet. This is the road. And we're going to go down that road. And we say, not so fast, P&P pavers. Holy Spirit gave us a better road. Holy Spirit has a road for us that's so beautiful, we don't even need to go down it. That's how beautiful that road is. We just look at the road and laugh and just say, wow, look how perfect it is. We don't even need to go down the road. It's good enough just from here. It's good enough just from here, just looking at it. So we beat P&P pavers to the punch. They don't know it yet. Oh, well, they know it because all minds are mind is one. But so maybe they'll say, ah, what's the use? We can't beat the Holy Spirit. It's not possible. Don't know what's going to happen in the next 6-7 days. Maybe something really, really, really earth-shaking that will get everybody's attention on the P&P paving company. And everybody's saying, please, please help. Oh my gosh, what's going on? Show us, you know, tell us what the road is to the future. You know, how to align our expectations, what our expectations should be, which that's the paving. That's how we pave the road into the future, is our expectations. Now, Holy Spirit showed us something so beautiful the road so beautiful. We said, "That's it. I don't have any expectations. This is perfect. This is all I need. I feel satisfied. This is just wonderful. I don't need to go down the road to find something better. This is flawless. This is perfectly fine. This is wonderful right here. I feel very satisfied just looking at it. Don't have to go down the road. Don't have to pursue anything. Don't have to seek anything. Don't have to go into the future. I don't know what's going on with the rest of the world. I just noticed that the Weather Channel, sometimes if it has to do with weather or something, then they'll have something on it. So don't worry about P&P Pavers Incorporated. They don't have the answer at all. The Holy Spirit has the answer. Now, I just noticed something, watching a YouTube video, and they have advertisements on it, you know. And I noticed something that I've noticed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times before. There's an equation, sometimes, you know, of movies and scripts. It's all like just these equations they use over and over and over and over and over. And one of the biggest equations they use, which is I notice is so misleading, is the how a man gets down in life, and the woman comes along and redeems him. You know, this is like one of the basic themes of all entertainment in the world. A good woman comes along and redeems the man that's fallen. You know, that kind of thing. And I said, hey, wait a minute. Have we ever seen a movie about the Holy Spirit? Isn't it the Holy Spirit that redeems? And I can say, it is. It's the Holy Spirit that's the Redeemer. And yet you never, never, ever, ever hear mention of that in secular world, do you? And so that road that you go down in a secular humanist world is all about humans, you know, helping redeem other humans. And usually it's the women who do the redeeming of the men. And they leave the Holy Spirit out of the equation. Now, certainly we can be helpful to one another, but there is no comparison whatsoever to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is incomparable, incomparable. And yet that's totally left out of the equation in a humanistic world. And ask yourself, is that what you really want? I mean, I know there's a lot of people that are posing like, you know, hey, I don't need the Holy Spirit. Oh, secular humanistic world is that way. We're having fun, you know. We don't need that. I saw a Van Halen video, you know, that brought back of what was that, the 80s. I think it was the 80s. And, the whole L.A. scene, and everybody was, you know, thinking, well, we're really having fun now. You know, now we're really having fun. Well, they always, you know, think something new comes along, and now we're really having fun. Oh, were they really having fun? I mean, flash forward now to this time, you know, and see, you know, their lives, are they happy? Are they fulfilled? I mean, is this what we really wanted in life, or we got what we wanted? Is that really it? We try so hard to have fun. We leave the Holy Spirit out of our lives. I don't need that. All I need is a good woman. You know, or a good man. Or some fun. You know, and this is, you know, incredibly foolish. And yet, again, I never really talk about the Holy Spirit moving around the world, because I know nobody wants to hear it. I don't hear anybody talking about the Holy Spirit socially at all. Very few people talk about Jesus. Very few people talk about God. It's almost not mentioned anymore in public. And certainly, I never hear the Holy Spirit mentioned in public. Just you go around. If, you know, someone asked me, well, why did you come out and play golf? I said, well, the Holy Spirit suggested I come out and play golf. They think I'm crazy, you know. But that's exactly what happened. I said, go hit a draw today. You're going to hit a draw today. I said, huh. That's interesting. Wow. That's a very intrigued. You know, that's coming from Spirit, coming from the Holy Spirit. People just think you're just a kook if you talk. So you, and just imagine a secular humanist world where this is, you know, the PMP pavers, they talk about climate change, and the pontiff is, you know, convenes all these radical activists, climate environmentalist people, and all this stuff. And they're getting together, and they're holding a conference, and they're studying it scientifically. And okay, great, great. There's nothing wrong with doing that. But shouldn't the Pope be talking to the world about the Holy Spirit? Our great Redeemer, our great Teacher, Redeemer. We're redeemed by the grace of the Holy Spirit, actually. Because it's the Holy Spirit that orchestrates our life, is with us all the time, and is aware of how to manage our success, how to help us manage our success and make the necessary strides that we need to make and evaporate the continuity fear, which we must do. By the way, people wonder, like, well, how many lies do I have to live? And it's very simple. You know, as long as you have not evaporated the continuity fear, you will continue to incarnate. There's no question about it. That's all along. And when you finally do evaporate the continuity fear, and which will lead to the vision of oneness, that's it. Incarnation is finished for you. Very cut and dried. Very black and white. Simple explanation. So, if those who do not spend their efforts evaporating the continuity fear, don't do anything about it, guaranteed they're going to have another identification with time, space, process, and form. In some place, you know, sometime, some place, some form, but they will be identifying with time, space, process, and form. It's absolutely certain. The continuity fear demands that. It says it demands that you believe that you're mortal, time, space, process, and form. And that you keep pretending that you're not spirit. So you'll keep pretending that you're not spirit. As long as that continuity fear is there, you'll keep pretending that you're not spirit. It's very simple. And when you spend your efforts evaporating the continuity fear under the grace of the Holy Spirit, then that's it. You're finished. You don't have to identify with time, space, process, form. You don't have to keep pretending you're something other than spirit. But it's not complicated. Now, I'm looking at the 18th hole, which is the finishing hole. It means we're getting up to the final something here. And all these turkeys flood the zone. The zone is completely flooded with, I've never seen so many turkeys. They were young, too. This is quite astonishing. Normally, in a flock of turkeys, you have some big adult turkeys and some young. These turkeys were all young. Let's just say 20 of them. They're all over the place. I'd never seen such a big flock of turkeys. And there was no adult turkeys. They were all young turkeys. We were joking about it. I says, look at all these turkeys. You know, and of course, turkeys mean people that really don't know what they're talking about. Stupid, foolish, you know, foolish. But look at those turkeys. But a bunch of turkeys. They don't get it. So those are on one side, and up ahead were these deer, and these graceful, elegant deer that were bounding and running so beautifully, you know, and they seemed so graceful and poised compared to the turkeys are just, you know, acting like turkeys. And with the deer, there were some young ones and some old ones there. I'm just wondering if that wasn't symbolizing something in the world, that there's a lot of young turkeys in the world, a lot of young people who are overconfident and reckless and thinking that you know, they have a smartphone, that means that somehow they're tuned into some sort of narrative that's going to satisfy them. And we would just say, what a bunch of turkeys, you know, why are they thinking that? It's foolish. And then the deer symbolizes the self, spiritual self. Very sensitive, very aware, very graceful, very elegant. Can be very swift action, you know, also very calm. And there's some in the world like that. Pretty amazing stuff here. What the Holy Spirit does, it puts on, like, you know, quote unquote street theater for you, life art, life theater, where your life becomes sort of like a theatrical. You feel like you're in a movie, sort of. There's some sort of theatrical production, but the Holy Spirit is somehow producing it, and all the world becomes a stage, and all the people upon it actors. As Shakespeare said, and the Holy Spirit is the producer of this, and you feel that way. And so we have this, the P&P pavers are going to be telling us that they've agreed upon a road for our a road into the future for all of us. And I said, not so fast, not all of us. Maybe the turkeys, that's where the turkeys are going. And pray tell, is that road the Holy Spirit? Because that's the only road we need, actually. The Holy Spirit is the only road we need. Put our road into the future in the hands of the Holy Spirit and say, here, Holy Spirit, you take care of our future for us. Isn't that what the pontiff is supposed to be saying? Vicar of Christ? The Good Shepherd? Telling people what Jesus wants them to know? Because Jesus, when he left, he said, hey, I'm leaving you the comfort of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's going to be your teacher now. And the Holy Spirit will clarify everything for you that you need to have clarified. Have put perfect faith in the Holy Spirit. And that was his instructions. That was Jesus' instructions. So shouldn't that pontiff be saying, look, everybody, yeah, we've got the climate and this, okay, all right, fine. But let's all put our lives in the hands of the Holy Spirit. And we know we're going to be, our future is going to be, actually, it'll become perfect. What does he need to go talk to the POTUS for? Let the Holy Spirit lead the way. Make it clear, make it clear, make it clear. Now maybe the Holy Spirit's saying, go see the POTUS, I don't know. It's possible. But they're not really talking about it, are they? I mean, this is one thing that's a little suspicious, to say the least. So, for instance, for me, I'm happy and eager to talk about the Holy Spirit. Say, hey, guess what? The Holy Spirit really helped out today. So don't you think that if they're really following the advice of the Holy Spirit and putting their lives and in the future in the hands of the Holy Spirit, that they would be eagerly talking about this and bringing it up and emphasizing this above everything else, actually? And of course, the religious people are very good at paying lip service, to whatever they need to do to appear to be, satisfying, some requirements. But, is it really the kind of enthusiastic, advocacy that you're hearing here? Because that's what's genuine. Unrestrained, enthusiastic advocacy of the Holy Spirit and saying, hey, guess what? The Holy Spirit told me that today to go, you're going to hit a draw, go try to hit a draw. And I had confidence that, wow, the Holy Spirit believes I can do it. And I did it. And it says, you see, you think that you can't get over, there's something you've been trying to do your whole life and haven't been able to do it. And you think you'll never do it. And what happens? Boom. You're able, finally able to do it. Well, guess what? That's going to happen spiritually too. I say, ah, thank you, Holy Spirit. You're absolutely tremendous. So is that road that P&P pavers are paving, is that the road of the Holy Spirit? Or is it a secular humanist road? Well, let's go down the road of, a utopia. Let's make a utopia here. Yeah, let's get everybody immunized. We'll give them, we'll shoot them full of every kind of inoculation, known and unknown, as yet unknown. And we'll keep giving them booster shots, and we'll take proactive efforts to make sure, they don't get sick. And we'll distribute the food better and have a better economy so everybody, gets a nice house and good music and a television set and get to watch all these wonderful not television shows and programming, 1,000 channels of, mind rot. And you know, they say, well, and we've done good works. We'll get to heaven. We've done good works. I didn't realize that Jesus said, I thought Jesus said, listen to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will, you know, guide you to do what you need to do, to know what you need to know. And Holy Spirit, you know, may or may not indicate good works. It's not about good works. It's about changing your perception, being willing to have your perception changed in such a way that you are willing to let go of the whole issue of status. You know, the I refers to status. You can look at it that way. What do I have? What's my status? And of course, as long as we're talking about status, we're denying perfection. So yeah, the I, when everything's perfect, you say, I don't need an I. I don't need someone who, I don't need any, you know, status measurement of status. This is better than status. And of course, we say, well, both is and isn't status. Maybe that's our nice draw, you know, goes to the right and then goes back to the left, and both is both right and left. The shot is both right and left. It both is and isn't status. By the way, that dog I told you was barking, that barking dog, I saw that dog again. I was walking and it starts barking at me, and I say, oh, let me start practice. I am now. I am the now. I am the now. And I started practicing. I was walking the dog, rah, 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 rah. I kept practicing, and as I got to the dog, there suddenly again, it went quiet again. It went quiet again. It's kind of like the dog said, wait a minute. I'm not quite sure if there's someone there to bark at or not. I'm used to barking at time, space, process, and form, and it seems like, it's like, you know, that seems to have, like, can't quite see it. You know, can't see the now. The dog can't see the now. Or maybe it is seeing the now and saying, oh, that's not so bad. Nothing to bark at there. So I've got a, you know, tremendous amount of wow reverberating. But this is what the path's all about, is you have to manage it. We have to manage our success. And so we need to be subdued. Both elated and there's some elation, but it's also, you keep it somewhat subdued. Because you realize, wow, if I try trying to express my elation, you know, maybe the wheels are going to come off here. Let me just stay subdued and humble here. Have humble hearts. And, you know, look to the Holy Spirit for redemption. It's the Holy Spirit that gives these exercises and practices we've been using and these clarifications. You know, it's not me, it's not someone else, it's not a human, you know, that giving these, this comes from the Holy Spirit. I just ask the Holy Spirit, okay, I'm open to suggestions, whatever you say. Let me hear what you have to offer. And then, you know, something will simply seem to emerge in my mind, like, wow, this is a, what a great idea. Where'd that come from? Never thought of that before. Well, that's the Holy Spirit. It gently lays these ideas into your mind. And it doesn't try to say, hey, I'm the Holy Spirit, here's an idea. No, it gently lays them, staying in the background, so that they sort of emerge in your mind. You sort of say, wow, what a great idea I just had. Where did that come from? And then you realize, wow, it must be the Holy Spirit, because it has that, it flips the script, and you know, it's like you can tell this is really extraordinary. He says, that didn't come from me. That's not usual for me. Wow. Now, the Holy Spirit will, of course, help the secular humanists out as much as they're willing to listen, but they might not, you know, they might be rather resistant to it for a while. rain today in the Bay Area. San Francisco, yeah, a bunch of rain. We didn't get any rain in the South Bay. But you can sure feel the moisture in there like it has rained. Very interesting. I heard that in Mexico, the reservoirs are full. They're spilling over. The rivers are just raging. I mean, there's just so much water there from El Nino. They're just getting hammered by so much rain. First time in, 10 years, the reservoirs spilled over. So there's a lot of moisture in the eastern Pacific and the mid and eastern, the whole Pacific area, equatorial Pacific area. It's hot. Water's hot. It's evaporating. A lot of moisture is going into the atmosphere. So we're at a mystical time in the world right now, big time. Because this is the time where we lay down expectations for the future. This is the moment that we decide, you know, what's our future going to be like? When we say we're at the tipping point, the pivotal time, this means that we feel like we need to decide on a course of action. You know, we can't wait any longer. We got to decide what's our future going to be like. Where, you know, what are our expectations, beliefs, you know, desires? How are we going to pave this road? What direction are we going to go in? We're at that time right now in the world. You know, we realize that we just can't, you know, let things just continue to boil. You know, people want a course of action. But we certainly don't want a course of action that is not inspired by the Holy Spirit, because that will take us into very severe delay. So we want a road that the Holy Spirit's road is what we want, actually. So we say, Holy Spirit, show us your road, so we can not go down the road, but just say, well, you know what, that's such a beautiful road, I don't even need to go down it. That's okay. This is it. That's such a beautiful road, because, you know, the continuity fear will say, well, you're not going down any road at all. And you know, the roads are supposed to go down a road, and say, well, actually, that's only, you know, continuity fear road. But the Holy Spirit's road is so perfect, you just say, wow, don't need to go down it. It's all good from where I stand. It's all perfect right now. And this is the tremendous difference between, you know, the humanism and Holy Spirit. You either choose the road the humanists lay out for you, or the road the Holy Spirit lays out for us. That's it. You're either a turkey or a deer. I saw so much old turkeys too. On the 10th hole, they were wandering out in front of me, and I said, hey, get out of the way. And I said, bam, bam, making noises, and they kind of wandered off a little bit, and then they came right back. And I said, come on, turkeys, get, you know, I don't want to hurt you, get out of the way. Those are the old turkeys, and they're late, they're lying there, just all lazy and tired, you know, and they really were, you know, whereas the young turkeys were kind of bustling around, you know, they had a bunch of energy. So, you know, young, what happens? Young turkeys turn into old turkeys. That's what happens. So we're not worried about what happens in the world. We just keep asking the Holy Spirit for greater help. Let's see your road, Holy Spirit, you know. Show us your road. Just that's it. Just show us your road. We want to. We're ready for your road. Show us your road. I believe that there's a global network of activism, extreme activism. When you look at the internet and what the internet, you know, crowdfundings, all the different ways that Facebook and Twitter and social media can use as pressure, and there's a whole global, the whole globe, especially the young turkeys, are ready. They want their marching orders. You know, they want to quote unquote fix the world. They say, hey, you know, we're here to save the world. So they're just waiting, you know, for an alignment to take place, which, you know, could very well happen when the PNP pavers get together, POTUS and the president, get the POTUS and the the POTUS, Popama, Popama, yeah, the single entity Popama, the POTIF. Anyway, when the pontiff and the POTUS get together, that may signal then the go signal for the activism in the world. And the activism could become extraordinarily strong. As I said, I believe it's going to be twice as strong as the activism in the Vietnam War, free speech, civil rights, black power, counterculture, 60s, you know, in early 70s, that whole time, which was just extreme. I mean, the blame game and the generational battles and everything was just horrendous. You know, as they say, don't trust anyone over 30 or something. I mean, the young people were just so rejecting of the older generation. It was horrendous. You were expected to, if you didn't reject the older generation, you were ostracized. I tried not to, you know, but fortunately I did listen to my elders a little bit here, and I wouldn't admit to it, you know, because you couldn't admit to that back then. And I guarantee you that the attitude of young people right now is toward the older generation, my generation, baby boomers, right on the edge of that. I don't consider myself a boomer, actually. I was maybe just like a year after, you know, 56 was not really a boomer. It's interesting, like for instance, the boomers had all their idols, their leaders, those they followed, stuff. I never really followed any of that, them. I was, you know, you kind of keep up with, you know, your older gen, those who are a little bit older than you when you're young. But truth is, I look back and no, I never ever really followed any of the boomers followed. They had their own, you know, leadership group for sure in all sorts of different ways. What I follow was A Course in Miracles, actually. When I was looking for, what do I follow in life? You know, I came across A Course in Miracles in 1978. And I said, this is what I'm going to follow for my life. This is, you know, the bell cow for my life. And that's what I've done. So, yeah, I'm not a boomer. So the criticism, you know, that the younger generation has for my generation, I don't really, you know, it just goes, it doesn't touch me. I don't feel it's applicable at all. And I don't think my life can be criticized. I've taken what I feel is the right path in life and made great decisions, super helpful decisions for everybody. Kept an extremely low carbon footprint. It's unbelievably low for my life. You know, the model, you know, of a low carbon footprint, actually. Never take vacations, never travel anywhere, just sit at home in my room, eat a vegetarian diet, you know, I mean, just super low consumer, super low carbon footprint, you know, and on and on and on. So I've, you know, been a model of, you know, what a good citizen should be like, in my opinion, both, you know, ecologically, socially, ecologically, and spiritually. So I don't have anything to feel guilty about at all. And thereby I don't feel that I'm, beholden, that someone has to lead me. I already have a leader, it's the Holy Spirit. I'm not going to let the young people lead me. I've already have a leader, it's the Holy Spirit, and nobody can criticize to me the Holy Spirit that it doesn't work. And the Holy Spirit does have the answer for us. So I don't feel intimidated by, the world. I don't have guilt. I don't feel intimidated. Doesn't matter what the young people say, socially, social media, blah blah blah. It doesn't really matter to me. They're not talking to me, is the way I look at it. I've led a, what I feel, virtuous life in a spiritual sense. Exemplary type of life. So, if they're interested in how they can lead an exemplary life, great. But it all starts with the Holy Spirit. It all starts with listening to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit may say, do this or do this. You just have to find out for yourself how the Holy Spirit will guide your life. I can't say, exactly what the Holy Spirit's going to say. It will guide your life uniquely to each one. Each one of us is unique guidance. The Holy Spirit didn't say to everybody, go out on the golf course and hit a draw today. I might be the only one in the world that it said that to today. But it was extremely significant, actually, because it's saying, here comes, the proficiency that you've been looking for your whole life. Guess what? You're ready for it. So the Holy Spirit's aware of everything, and including, what PNP Pavers is going to do. And so he's saying, you better be ready for this. He's giving urgency. Come on, get ready for it. Gotta get ready for it. Do everything you can to get ready for it. So I've been really stretching and, moving around, dieting, what I had today. Grapefruit juice, a little cup of yogurt, a little bit of yogurt with some honey nuts, walnuts and blueberries, and some butternut squash soup. That's it. With some croutons. That's it. That's all I had today. Grapefruit juice, a little bit of yogurt, and some butternut squash. So I'm trying. I'm not really losing that much. I went back up. It's amazing. I'm the only person that can, like, fast and gain weight, basically, It's a maybe it's a miracle. The world's looking for, how to, like, have no food and still gain weight. Maybe that the Holy Spirit's just saying, hey, you can do that too. That's something that can happen. That, but I did eat a little bit of food, and that's all it takes to boom, put on 2 pounds. And one night, I ate a good meal, for dinner, and put on 2 pounds. That's how it goes. A little bit frustrating, but anyway, everything's trending in the right direction. See, good habits, good habits, good habits. Listening to the Holy Spirit, not listening to the news, not interested in playing any blame game or who the leaders are, because it's the Holy Spirit that's the leader of my life. Now, what will the Holy Spirit say next? I don't know. I wish it would do more, tell you the truth. It doesn't tip its hand. It's always in the now. It always does exactly what we need right now. So I can't tell. I can't say what is it going to do next. I don't know. But I'd sure like to have some sort of, you know, something, momentum, get going in some way. We're going to need it. We're going to need it. We're going to need those who exemplify the path of the Holy Spirit in the world to say, hey, folks, you know, the PMP pavers, let's not go down their road. That's not, you don't really want that at all. It's a gilded road, you know, it's a primrose path, actually. Very much a primrose path. And it starts getting real dark after a while. Before you know it, you're in some dark tunnel. And you're just like, oh my gosh, where's the light, you know? Yeah, no. Doing here in this video? Pretty good. Pretty good. You'll be seeing this on the 17th. A lot of people are jittery. There's no question about it right now. Not without reason. Look at that big earthquake that's already struck, right? People have been, today, yesterday, I mean, leading up, people are like, I can't sleep. I just wake all night. I can't shut my mind. I can't sleep. But my feeling is just, what can you do? You just ask the Holy Spirit and turn your life over to the Holy Spirit. And what else can you do, really? And just be, you know, meek and humble as far as, you know, managing your success. On the 18th hole, pulled the approach shot a little bit. Was down a bank in thick rough, blind shot to the pin. Very difficult situation. I said, "Oh wow, this is really terrible." Well, it hit a great blind pitch shot to about 6 feet away or something. So, hit the putt, and it looked like it barely last tiny trickle. Boom. It dropped in. Par the 18th. Very difficult hole. I walked off with a smile and said, you see, it all ends well here. It all ends well. It may seem we're in a very difficult position, but I had the right technique. Everything, I did everything right. So I said, well, I'll just let the chips fall where they may. But I know, you know, I'm gonna approach it like this. I know I'm gonna hit it good, and we'll see if it gets close. Oh, it got pretty close. I know how to, you know, I'm gonna put a good putt on it. I know I will, and everything turned out great. So, you know, you just have to have confidence in the Holy Spirit and say, yeah, the Holy Spirit has prepared me well, and so everything's gonna be great. Everything's gonna be wonderful. It's truly a miracle that somehow I'm sitting here feeling the way I'm feeling and having the momentum and the good habits. I mean, just 2 weeks ago or so, you know, I was just like feeling like that I'd never ever lose weight again. I'm going to be very, very overweight and all sorts of infirmities. And never exercise, never do anything again as far as moving around. And, you know, all this stuff, I said, well, what can I do? You know, I just don't feel motivated or the will or whatever. the Holy Spirit really hasn't said to do anything, so I don't, what can I do? I don't feel the Holy Spirit's inspiring anything. And then suddenly that situation occurred where I you know, got invited, you know, and suddenly I said, oh gosh. And then from then on, everything has suddenly changed. And I recognized, I said, hey, I feel this is a pivotal moment. I think this is going to change my life right now. And it did. It has. So I recognized the hand of the Holy Spirit in that whole situation. And now it's like, wow, I feel like, you know, that everything is going in the right direction. And the Holy Spirit's ready for some action. Ready for some action. And before it said, no, just keep. You know, keep on the spiritual path. Don't do anything else. Just focus. And now it's saying, okay, now's the time for some action. So great. Body seems to be functioning okay. Infirmities seem to be maybe getting a little better with some exercise and stuff. And so I feel like, yeah, I can keep, you know, going along maybe a little longer here. That's a pretty amazing. So don't give up on yourself. You know, you don't know. The Holy Spirit can pull some tactic on you like it did on me, and wonderful tactic. Where I said, if I get invited, I can't really say no. Oh my gosh, what if he really follows through on that and says, hey, let's go play golf today? Oh my gosh, I can't really say no. It'd be bad form, you know, and I have to, you know, start getting the rust off of my whole situation. Get the rust off. So you might be feeling sick and feeling your life's over and have no motivation and et cetera, et cetera. You may be just studying, you know, spiritually practicing. Say, I'm finished, you know. But you should never give up on the Holy Spirit. Just keep doing the very best that you can do, whatever the guidance is. And if you need to get going, the Holy Spirit will find a way to motivate you. It will find a way to motivate you. When it's time for you to go this way or do this, it will find a way for you for sure. Never sell the Holy Spirit short. Just don't think, oh, he's helping you out, but the Holy Spirit's helping you out, but well, don't help me. No, that's not true at all. The Holy Spirit is aware of every last detail there is and is there to help everyone. We have a globe full of people that don't realize that and keep going to, you know, humans, human intellect and the pretense, it was just intellect and the continuity fear. Keep going to the continuity fear. Hey, continuity fear, they say, what should I do? Continuity fear says, well, first of all, you realize how smart you are in asking me for advice. And I mean, you know, they start flattering you. Like, oh, really? Oh, yeah. I mean, that's right there, a sign of brilliance. And then, of course, if you then don't ask, you think you'll lose your brilliance. But it's flattery. The continuity fear is expert at flattery. It knows how to flatter us. And so we're just like, you know, putty in its hands, you know, it seems like. So we're not too worried about what happens in the world. We just keep full blast on with the Holy Spirit. But there's no question the Holy Spirit has given a great sense of urgency. There's also no doubt that I've been shown over and over in many, many, the biggest display of predictors, predictive programming, so to speak, in this life theater that I've ever experienced about impacts, you know, from rocks or, you know, some sort of impacts. Now, that could just keep mean a rock, or it could mean, you know, just impacts, meaning real strong, you know, humanism, like real, and be impacted by beliefs and determination and of, you know, of secular humanism impacting the world. And, you know, it could be that, or it could actually be some space rocks. You know, I don't know. I don't know exactly. But certainly there's been this massive, look at this that I've experienced. I'd say, okay, but I mean, what do we do about it? I mean, you know, just if some space rocks hit, you know, what are we supposed to do about it? I mean, can I stop it, you know, from happening? I mean, where do you go? I mean, I don't know exactly what the point of it is. But, you know, hopefully we'll find out. I hope, you know, as this morning I was thinking about it, and I said, I really hope it's not any space rocks. Absolutely. This is my prayer, you know, desire for the world is nothing happens in that way at all. I don't think anybody wants that, really. If they really look inside, you know, everything's a mess here. The world is going the wrong direction. It's all this trouble. But we do not want to get hit by any space rocks, you know, period. I realize very strongly that I feel this way. We don't need that. The world's tough enough as it is right now. We don't need that. So hopefully everyone can just say no to that. Absolutely not. No. Stay away. You know, let's keep working. You know, let the Holy Spirit keep working here, and let's just find a way without space rocks hitting the world, because that, you know, we don't need any extinction level event here. We absolutely do not. I don't want that in the slightest bit. Maybe there's some that do. You're right. I've spoken of that earlier, that it may create the chaos that many, many powerful interests want, to give them an excuse to seize control. Martial law, all sorts of things. You know, this is, hey, you know, this is the excuse we've been waiting for. The crisis, this is the crisis we've been waiting for. Many, many powerful groups, you know, see the road to power through, you know, crisis. The crisis is the road to power for them. And they don't like things to just go on the way they are, because they think, we can't quite, you know, seize control of people's willingness. But if there's a crisis, people might say, oh my gosh, help, 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 help. We'll agree to anything. You know, so they hope for crises and pray for crises, I believe, and even engineer crises. But we don't want a crisis, no way. Because all of us, whether we know it or not, are always trying to really go get back to what we really are and drop pretension. And we don't really want to keep delaying unnecessarily at all. We don't really want to go down a road of delay. And we really don't want to have chaos here and get under control of those who would try to march us down that road of delay. We really don't want that. So that's how I feel. And, you know, if it were to happen, you know, I wouldn't want to hang around a world where that's going through an extinction level event situation like that. No, it doesn't interest me, really. I don't want that. I know that there's that there is, the Holy Spirit has a way to liberate us from our, you know, from our continuity fear, and there is an answer for us, and we get this by quiet, calm contemplation, spiritual practice in a stable environment. I don't want chaos. I want a stable environment. I want a peaceful, stable world. Because that's what's best to, this is what enables us to do the gentle evaporation of the continuity fear over, you know, takes quite a while. That's what enables us to do this. You know, stability, peace and stability. We don't want some new world order. We don't want chaos. We don't want massive change. It's not necessary. We can do all the change we need just sitting quietly. That's it. That's all we need to do is just sit quietly and practice this way. Affirmations, full stop on the while, flipping the script. That's all we need to do, really. Now, it's very difficult for young people to see this because they want action. They want action, 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 action. I was playing, you know, golf with someone today and just happened to be paired with someone. And actually, they caught up with me on the 11th hole and I invited them to join me. You know, you don't have to wait. Let's join me and we'll play. And so he was, you know, pretty good. Hit the ball a long way. And we got to one hole. It's a par four, and the green's like about, you have to hit it about 290 in the air or something. I mean, it's too far. And he said, "No, I'm going to try to drive the green." You know, I said, "Yeah, I don't think you're not going to be able to do it. You're going to end up in the creek or in the arroyo or something." You know, he said, "Well, this is my only time here." You know, he wasn't from around here. He says, "It's my only time here. I might as well just, you know, go for it anyway. I'm going to go for it." Well, you know, he blasted one way right and blasted one way left and lost a couple balls and that was it. You know, I told him, you know, you're not going to be able to make it. He was reckless there. And then on the 18th hole, he was on a side hill in thick grass, like 240 some odd yards away from the green over a huge tree. And he said, "What do I do here?" I said, you got to lay up. And he says, "Okay, now that you said that, I'm going to go for it." You know, and he pulls out a 3-wood, and I say, it's too much, man. I don't think you can hit the green from here. It's too difficult a shot, you know. And he says, no, I'm going to go for it. And so he nails this shot, you know, as hard as possible. And it looks like it's going to make it. Oh, it's going to make it. It's going to make it. It's going to make it. Oh, my gosh. No, boom, it hits the oak tree and drops down. You know, I said, and comes up, you know, 30 yards short or something or more. And I said, look, you know. And then another hole, hit a fantastic drive on 17. He had 208 yards to the green. And I say, look, it's uphill. There's a strong wind. It's cold. It's this hole plays longer than you think. And he's gonna hit a hybrid. I said, no, that's not gonna get there. Hit a 5-wood, because I know the course. You know, he never played before. I said, you need at least a 5-wood to get there. He says, no, I can reach you with a hybrid. And so what happens? Boom, you know, he comes up 30 yards short, 20, 30 yards short, in the side of a bunker, you know. If he hit the 5-wood, really crushed it, he probably would have got there. So, you know, recklessness, overconfidence, you know, youth, right? Youth. Youth says, no, I can do it. I know. Overestimating their capabilities. This is the problem with the youth. It's always a problem, but, you know, now it's a severe problem. I mean, I was the voice of reason there, you know, an elder who's played this course so many times. I knew exactly what to say to him. I said, you know, it plays longer than you think by a long shot, by a long ways. And the atmospheric conditions, everything. So, didn't listen. It's okay. He said, I'm out here to have fun. But, you know, sometimes, you know, you need to be serious and listen to older people with experience. And this is the problem, I think, with the young people today. They're reckless and overconfident to a large extent, very severe extent. So they want action, action, action. They want to push an agenda through. I'm saying no. The continuity fear is way worse than you realize. Just like that, I say that distance, the hole is way more than you think. You're not going to get there. And indeed, they did not get there and got into very bad situations there. Same thing, okay. Continuity fear is way worse than young people realize. They don't realize how severe it is. It's super severe. It's the only problem we have, but it's super severe. And so we need peace and calm and stability, and you need to spend your lifetime working at it. But they say, no, let's push through utopia, and you know, we should be able to get it just like that. Doesn't work that way with nothing succeeds like familiarity, and it's impossible to get familiarity just like that. By very definition, familiarity means that you can't get it just like that, that you've got to spend, you know, again and again and again and again and again and again and again. It's like, let's say, a couple has a child and one of the parents leaves and the child never knows the parent at all. And then the parent returns back after the child's now 20-year-old or something, you know. Say, hey, I'm your parent, you know, your long-lost parent. You don't know me. We've never talked or never seen each other, never spent any time with each other. But hey, you know, we're on the same page and like we always known each other, right? And the kid goes, what are you talking about? I mean, I've never done anything with you. I have zero familiarity with you. We might start somewhere, you know, go have a lunch or something. But I mean, you know, I spent 20 years with my friends and my parent that stayed with me. And, you know, that's what I'm familiar with. I'm not familiar with you at all. And maybe the adult will say, you know, like, what? I thought I could just come back, you know, into your life and, you know, we just click. And said, no, I mean, I feel you know, some sort of, you know, blood relation with you. Maybe I feel something, but I don't have any familiarity with you. It might take us 20 years to get to know one another, you know. So it's like that. You can't just click and read a book and, oh, yeah, then now. Okay. No, it doesn't work that way. Familiarity is what wins. Familiarity is what wins. And so if you're overconfident and reckless, you know, I don't have time to wait for familiarity. I got to just push through success. It won't work. It'll backfire for sure. You'll lose your way. So what I want is stable stability. Prosperity, stability, calm, peace, smooth, kind of boring, you know. It's okay, you know, get a car, drive the car for 30 years, that's fine. Get stuff, let it last for 30 years or whatever, that's fine. I mean, you have this idea that, you know, 30 years of effort in a certain direction, that's not too much, that's not, you know, it's not amazing, or you know, it used to be people, you know, spend your life, you know, spiritual contemplation, you know, spend your whole life at it, of course. So that's not unusual. But now, I mean, everybody's got to get new right now. You have the idea of like, what, you got something that's 30-year-old car, what are you talking about? That's crazy. No, it's not crazy at all. It's just our expectations have got completely messed up. Excuse me. My breathing just got attacked, or just got severely. Wow. breathing became all erratic suddenly. The windpipe, the tracheal tube, suddenly became very irritated and started getting all jumpy there. I was not able to breathe smoothly. It's still doing it. Okay. I'll stop in a while. You know, like if when you're starting to get some cold or flu or something, and you try to take a breath and suddenly you start coughing, you can't, you know, it's like that, but it's more erratic than that. It's all whoa, jumpy like this, the breath. We're so used to our breath being just even and steady, you know, that when it suddenly becomes unsteady, it's quite a shock. This came out of nowhere. It got jumpy. I was just talking, and suddenly it got super jumpy. The breath. We don't realize that can even happen, hardly, right? I was so caught unawares by it, I coughed a couple times. Usually I'm able to suppress the cough and deal with it mentally, but it hit so fast and hard, a couple of coughs came out. Fritz Kafka. It was Kafka-esque moment there. So that is quite alarming. Amber, we're almost at midnight, almost at the 17th, just before we reach midnight here, Pacific Coast time. Suddenly, my breath, something seized upon my breath, and it suddenly became erratic. The world is about to be pulsed. What was that? Did we just get hit with some sort of pulse? Some psychic pulse? Some mental pulse of some sort? Wow. Some strange animal sound is being made there. But they expect a tsunami to hit the West Coast, California coast, about 4 o'clock in the morning tonight. Somewhere around there. Must be a long way to Chile, huh? It takes that long to get here. It's traveling fast. It's not supposed to be too high, but the overall surge, the wavelength can be extremely long. That's pretty interesting. A tsunami hitting the west coast on the 17th. As I've been saying, the 17th is this very critical day. A sudden surge. A tidal surge hitting the west coast. Hey, Chile already got hit by a tidal surge. Hawaii's going to get hit by something. West coast will be hit something on the 17th. Hawaii and California. Pretty interesting, huh? Holy Spirit's giving out some good information. That's the timing. Shook up my entire system. When your breath suddenly becomes erratic, that shakes up your whole system. I feel okay. So, if this happens to you, you just know what to do. You sit quietly, it's okay. You just full stop in the wow. We don't know what's going to happen. I mean, there's so much overconfidence and youth in the world. In recklessness, in odd choices coming out of that, that you know, things could really become unhinged in so many ways. I'm telling you, it's just wow. The road of the future may suddenly, you say, you know, everyone will suddenly say, "Hey, this is it, we found it," and you may look at it and say, "Are you kidding me? Oh, no way." So, who knows how erratic everything's going to get. I just felt this suddenly became erratic. So, you know, right, I mean, in you know, the East Coast, most of the world, it's already the 17th. So, I felt a sudden surge of erraticness hit me. I got hit by it. And I came momentarily erratic, the whole thing. My whole system became erratic there. Right on the 17th here. For much of the world, it's already the 17th. Wow. Holy Spirit's in control. Holy Spirit is in control. And everything, our road will get fabulous. Our road's going to get absolutely fabulous. No question about it. Okay, very great. That's enough for this one. I'm going to get some rest. And we'll see you on the flip side of the 17th. That's it.